Hello, everyone. Welcome to our Monday live stream. We have a very exciting live stream today. We have Gary from the Rusted Garden joining us in just a couple of minutes. So thanks to all of you who are there early in the chat. I'm just building up excitement for the live stream. Everybody's really looking forward to seeing Gary, and I am too. He's actually live in the green room right now. So Cliff and Isha, if you guys could let me know if you can see and hear me okay, because we are using our new live streaming software. Oops, and let me turn my phone down here. Just let me know how everything looks, and we'll be bringing Gary in just a moment. So welcome, you guys. Hope you guys had a great weekend. It's beautiful weather here in Southern California. I think today is around 80 or 85. Cooled off from the warm temperatures of last week. We had temperatures in the 90s, 95 degrees. It was absolutely crazy. So really happy it's a little bit cooler, and hopefully it'll help the cooler vegetables last. Hang on here. I'm just making a couple adjustments. Last just a little bit longer. We were able to get a couple of really nice days of photo shooting in for the new book last week. Got the nasturtiums all photographed, so those will be in there. So really looking forward to that. And I was very thankful that they didn't die before we were able to take photos. So let's say hello to those of you that were here in the chat. Let's see here. Hello to Patricia. Thank you so much, Patricia. She's here every week. Is Gary actually on the screen? Are you guys seeing him on the screen now? I guess you are. So I thought I didn't bring him in yet, but let me know if you can see him on the screen or if it's just me. I think you're actually on the screen, Gary. So
that could be.
Okay, anyway, I might as well introduce you. For those of you that don't know, this is Gary from The Rusted Garden. Many of you know and love his YouTube channel, The Rusted Garden, and many of you have bought seeds from him as well. And Gary and I have actually been friends for, I don't know, Gary, maybe now 10 or 11 years, I think.
I think since we almost started our channels, yeah.
That's right. So Gary was actually, after we started our channel, Gary's one of the first people that kind of came alongside of us and said, go for it, you guys. He was a big encouragement, and he really saw potential in us, probably actually more than we saw in ourselves at the time. But it was super encouraging to Jerry and I, and we got to be good friends with him. We had a chance to meet him several times over the years and actually go out to see his new homestead garden out in Maryland a couple years back. So Gary, welcome so much to our Monday live stream. If one of our moderators can let me know if you can actually see both of us on the screen. I think we can, but I just want to make sure that we're all cool with that.
I can see us. So
can you see us, Gary? Okay, I think I can too.
Yeah.
So someone let us know how things are looking here. This is kind of new to me here to stream with another person. So I'm just going to scroll down to the bottom and see, make sure I can see my moderators are all good. I don't know if I have a delay on the chat or not, but anyway, guys, here's Gary. Welcome to the show, Gary. And let's just kick it off here. Since we talked about your new homestead, which I guess you've actually been there a couple of years now, right? At your new place?
Yep, season three in the garden.
Season three, very cool. And we had the opportunity to come the first season where you built the garden from the ground up and pretty much built it from a blank slate. Just a grassy area, and now have a gorgeous, I don't even know how many square foot garden, but it's very large and absolutely beautiful. But the thing I actually wanted to talk about first was you have a very unique home as well. It's an old home, I think over 100 years old. So maybe can you tell us just a little bit about that, and then we can get into the garden a little bit as well.
Yeah, so when my kids are 22, 25, I think that's right. So when they got older and moved out, instead of downsizing, we sort of upsized. So I wanted to live on 4 or 5 acres somewhere really far away, but my wife wanted something more social. So we kind of found this place. The house is an 1867 farmhouse. So it's the original house of the owners of the land for, you know, the last couple hundred years. So the home is old. It's 2 acres, which is perfect size. It was flat, rectangle, and really kind of fit what I wanted. Something unique in the older home, and then enough land to kind of turn it into the homestead or the edible landscape, but just have fun with it. And it's like one of the best things that's happened to me in
that's my great life. And I know you're actually sitting in your kitchen right now, and it really has a farmhouse kind of homestead type of feel. So the house,
yeah, it tilts.
It tilts, right?
The floor's tilting this way, yeah. So,
but it's absolutely beautiful. And if you watch his videos, you might see it sometimes in the background of some of his videos. But it's really beautiful. And the garden is pretty incredible as well. Now, the one thing that I love about your garden is it's complete full sun because you have so much space out there, which for me here in the city, I'm constantly dealing with shade from surrounding trees, from fences, from things like that. So I was really amazed at how much the vegetables grow better in full sun. So that was pretty cool. And it actually inspired me to come back and like we did some tree trimming and things like that to kind of open up the sunlight a little bit. But obviously, you know, we're here on the West Coast in California, and you being there on the East Coast, there's huge differences in our climates. So talk a little bit about if you were to drop a West Coast gardener out in the East Coast, what would the differences be? What would they have to deal with? What might they be surprised about, you know, gardening on the East Coast as opposed to out here in a southern climate on the West Coast?
Well, you drop them here in January, it would be 20 degrees and snow on the ground.
That'd be a shock.
If you dropped them here, yeah, in July, it's probably as hot as it is there, but the humidity gets to 100%. So most people aren't used to that. And it affects the garden in a sense, like we were talking a little bit earlier. I think the West Coast gets more insects, powdery mildew a little bit, but here, because of the humidity, we get all kinds of diseases, leaf spot, early blight, powdery mildew is pretty bad. Some insects, but not as bad maybe over there. Although I don't know, do you have that white butterfly that flies around the green?
We do, yes. The cabbage loopers.
Okay. So that's everywhere.
Yes.
So, I mean, that's one of the biggest things. And then we just get tons of rain. Like people are amazed at the size of my garden that I don't have a drip system. I don't really need it till maybe July, first week of August, but I hand water. Because we get so much rain. I mean, we literally can get inches of rain in one day. Like
that's
fills
crazy.
Up a whole wheelbarrow, you know. So that's great. And the soil's more clay, which has tons of micronutrients in it. Once you get it set up, it really has a nice level of those micro elements for the plants. You should move down here. We can do more videos.
Well, I don't know if I could handle the cold for one thing. But yeah, when we went there in July 2 years ago, I was amazed at the rain. I mean, we get rain a couple times a year here in California. And I could not believe what a difference it made in the growth. I don't think I've ever seen it rain so hard as I saw at your house. And I think you mentioned the wheelbarrow did completely fill up with water, which I was shocked. In fact, I think I mentioned, hey, Gary, why don't we do a video on, I'll show you how to install drip irrigation. And you said, I don't need drip irrigation because we get plenty of rain. And I was absolutely shocked. So that really opened my eyes up to a lot of the differences too.
And one of the things, and I think you can almost see 3 days later after rain, you can see the tremendous growth. And for people just starting, generally speaking, most plants have the deep roots that go into the ground and then they have the shallow roots. And a lot of the drip irrigation gets the shallow roots. But where you have hot temperatures or the sun's beating down and you don't get a lot of rain, those surface roots can really be damaged. So it slows the growth of the plant. So you'd be amazed using mulch, maybe drip irrigation, but I mean, if you don't have it, you don't have it. But when the rain is regular, those surface roots just bring in a lot of moisture and the plants do really take off, I think, more over here.
That's crazy. I never actually thought of that. So if I don't have drip irrigation, my plants die. And I'm always encouraging people to put it in. But I had to kind of add in after I went to see you, if you're not getting consistent rain, drip irrigation is really the way to, you know, get water consistently to your plants. But in areas where you get rain, you may not actually need drip irrigation. It may be fine with a little bit of supplemental watering at certain times of the year. Well, we'll get into another question in just a moment, Gary. But let's jump into chat and maybe answer a couple of questions in between, you know, our chat here. Let me just kind of scroll through. Let's see. Let me scroll through on my phone here on the side and see what kind of questions. And if you see any that, you know, you want to answer, jump in as well. A lot of people, I love everybody's encouraging comments. Thank you so much for just all your support of both Gary and I over the years. People are saying that, you know, they really enjoy our videos and have learned a lot from us. And that's always encouraging and motivating, inspirational to me as well. And I'm sure it is to Gary also. Rod, thank you. It's great to have you here from Baja. Great to see you both and hear you both perfect. I'm actually going to scroll down to the bottom of the chat here. See if we have any questions. Oh, here's a good question for you, Gary, from 13 Moons Homestead. Gary, do you keep any livestock?
No. And I might. We have like a little tiny community association, so I can keep donkeys and horses. I can't keep sheep. I can have hogs. But before I get to animals, I kind of wanted to build up the garden because that's my thing. And that's, you know, the book that I just wrote is Modern Homestead Gardening. But I want to bring in the animals when I can take care of them full time and I'm not, you know, moving around and stuff like that.
That's a good idea.
But I definitely want to get chickens and I want to actually, you know, maybe get some rescue animals or something that can just kind of hang out and live their life out here.
That'd be cool. That'd be cool. So yeah, you focused on the garden first and then hopefully move into the livestock. Nisha, our moderator here, actually just moved to Colorado from Northern California. So she's dealing with the climate changes, just like we had talked about as far as from the West Coast and then to a winter climate. And she was asking when to start a garden after a move. Kim and Gary, do you have any suggestions about when to start a garden after a move? Any thoughts on that, Gary?
I would go right away.
I would say the same.
I mean, once you know the space, I mean, you were talking a little bit about sunlight. It's always worth picking a day when it's sunny out. And now probably because the leaves are on the trees, it's even better. But go out at 8 o'clock a.m., 10 a.m., 12 p.m., 2 p.m. and just kind of mark where the sun is. And that will let you kind of set the best place for the different crops. But once you figure that out, I would get started right away. And then I do recommend, I don't know how much she's been gardening before, but start small because you can always add to it. And I would go all in, you know. One of the nicest things about moving here is I got to take all the years of experience and kind of put it into a clean slate. So everything I built really came from experience and I'm really happy with how it turned out.
Yeah, I would say the same, Gary. Just, you know, jump in, Nisha. Now she has a much larger space than she had before. She was only able to grow in containers before. So it's exciting to have a brand new fresh slate to be able to build some new raised beds, pop in some containers, and then start with all the vegetables that you grew before and add some new ones in there as well. So, get going there. Okay, Gary, let's go back and talk about... Okay, I think we kind of talked already about some challenges you deal with in Maryland that are different than what we deal with on the West Coast, the disease issues, the bug issues. We have the drought issues here, which you don't have. I did want to mention, though, that you do have a new book, which I see on the shelf back behind you. And I just actually got my copy last week. Finally got it from Amazon. And I had a chance to flip through it. I know, it's weird to see on the screen here. It's a different screen for me, too. It's not a full screen. So this is the Modern Homestead Garden. And if you guys have not had a chance to pick this up, you can get on Amazon. I know you can get on Gary's website, therustedgarden.com, a signed copy, right, Gary, from you? They're interested in a signed copy?
Yes, you can.
Grab them from you? Okay. Yeah. So this is all about, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, you can go to therustedgarden.com and I do sell the signed copies there for only a couple dollars more. So certainly.
Cool. Okay, awesome. It's always fun to have a book signed by an author. Gary and I are actually with the same publisher, Cool Springs Press. So that's kind of neat. But you talk about homesteading being a lifestyle. Now, I always thought homesteading was you had to have like a big piece of land. I never thought of myself as a homesteader, but you kind of took a spin on that and put a whole new, new look on homesteading. Can you kind of explain a little bit what a modern homestead garden is? And you have to have a lot of land.
No, you don't need a lot of land. And we talk about an hour on this. So my whole spin on this is that homesteading originally, historically, was to get people on the East Coast when the United States was young, get them out to the West Coast, populate the land out there. So you had to establish you could manage the land, and then you would get the land. So that was great. And then over the years, the principles of gardening, raising livestock, there's so much included in homesteading that I decided to focus on modern homestead gardening. Because I think over the years, we've become accustomed to you go and buy your food. You know, when you buy your food, you have a limited amount. People seriously don't know where radishes come from. If you say, do they come from a tree or the ground? They're not sure.
Yeah.
People think food comes from the grocery store. So the whole idea was that you don't have to move off grid. You don't need 5 acres or 10 acres. You don't have to do things kind of primitively, with minimal stuff. If you ever watch the shows like I think Alaska, The Last Frontier, all those kind of things.
Yeah, I love those.
Yeah, they're Yeah, I love them. They're off grid and stuff like that, and they're doing stuff on their own, but they bring in $250,000 excavators and machinery and stuff like that. So, you know, homestead in quotations. The modern homestead is really to help us get that vision back that we can be more self-sufficient. We can learn the skills. We can start with small containers. We can develop how we garden. And then as you grow, you can get more land and more land, and you can do more for yourself. You can go to community gardens if you don't have the property. I recommend people check with family and friends where you can tend the land, raise the crops and share with them, but they give you the land. But it's really a way to kind of break that idea of you work 9 to 5, you consume your food from the grocery store, and you do less for yourself. It works, you know, but the modern homestead garden is really about beginning to do more for yourself.
So it's really a shift in your mindset, you know, to just be more self-sustainable, but yet not, I like what you're talking about in your book, like do a little bit at a time. You don't have to feel overwhelmed. Like I have to do this all at once. I have to grow all my own food, compost everything, right. You know, have chickens, you know, do everything. You know, I think I talked to you in my book about starting simple and then expanding later. And I always encourage people to start very simple. And that's exactly what you're talking about too in your book, is just get started with, even if it's just with one or two things. And if you're composting a little bit more than you were last year, or even if you just start a compost pile, but you're working towards the goal of being a little bit more self-sufficient each time, you know, you learn a new skill.
Exactly. So, and I think I recall in your book, you talked about, or even in your videos, going to the backyard grocery store.
Yes.
You know,
garden grocery store.
Instead of visiting. Yeah. Instead of going, you know, out and shopping, you go and you pick out of your garden, and you take that time with your cup of coffee, or like when I do my rambling series, I just walk around and look at what's grown, appreciate what I created and helped along. But you're also pulling out great produce that you can use. And you're absolutely right, is you don't have to give everything up, go get several acres and just start everything, you know. That's really difficult to do,
and anyway. A lot of people can't do that. You know, some people are growing on a balcony or a deck, or just a small patio in a condo. And I think it is still possible, definitely, to grow a good portion of your own food, even if you have a very small space. I mean, even if you grow just your own salads, or you grow the vegetables that you have with your meals every week, you know, like you said, you don't have to have tons and tons of acreage. So I think it's a great, great concept. And it's a really nice mind shift for people to have with that, that it's something that is attainable and they definitely can do. So, yeah.
Right.
So great book, guys. I highly recommend you picking up a copy. Grab a signed copy from Gary over on his website. And our books actually go pretty well in tandem with each other. I mean, you have a lot of plant profiles in your book here. Whoops, that's my book. In your book. And then I don't recall if, do you actually go into like how to start from seed step by step and grow lights? I flipped through like maybe the first half, but I'll cover a lot of that in my book too. So they make a good pair there.
Yeah. Yours is a little bit more detailed. And what I found like writing the book, I actually wrote, I think like 60,000 words. So I had to cut it down to fit into the book. But there's 1,000 ways to plant. And that's one of the things like I wanted to encourage, is the mindset is that you can read your book and you'll have a fantastic garden. You could read my book, you'll have a fantastic garden. You could blend both of them, you'll still have a fantastic garden. You don't get a doubly fantastic garden.
Right.
And the whole idea is getting started, like, you know, read, watch videos, practice. But if you're not out there getting your hands dirty and you're not failing, then you're not really kind of learning. And that's how I learned. That's the way most people learn. And that's what really works. There's 1,000 ways to plant seeds.
Absolutely. And it's getting out there and experimenting and, you know, not being afraid to do that. And I always say too, like, it's not a failure if something doesn't work out. It's just a learning experience. We've all made a million mistakes. I have plants that die all the time, as I know you do too. But if that never happened, we would never figure out what actually works in our climate, because it's different for all of us. Like we talked about, we're on different coasts. We have different ways of growing, different watering issues, different pest issues, disease issues. And it's just figuring out what works for you, kind of the sweet spot. Everyone has their own sweet spot. And depending on what you like to do as well, you might not like to grow in containers, but you love growing in raised beds. So just do whatever you enjoy, what brings you pleasure, and what works in the area that you live in. So let's jump back into the chat and answer a couple more questions. There's a lot flying by here today. Tommy Daly, hi, how are you? It's nice to see you here again. Let's see here. Thandali from South Africa. Very cool. First time on your live chat. That's awesome. 12:19 or 21:19 p.m. I'm not sure. Is that like, I think that's pretty late in the evening, but thanks for joining us all the way from South Africa. So let's see here about some questions. Here's a good question from.
I got a question.
Go ahead.
So someone asked from Maryland, is it safe to plant all your summer crops? And I always say yes. And then the frost comes. But I really think, and I just put all my tomatoes out, or half of them this weekend. I think it's safe now to plant in Maryland, zone 7, cool. Get the warm weather crops out.
What's your official frost date there?
The 15th, but I've been watching the weather channel. They give you a nice 10-day advance, and the night temperatures are just really high. So I think we're going to get past that.
Good. Well, Cliff, our moderator, lives in Idaho, and he puts his tomatoes out super early. He's got this fantastic thing he's found called the Wall of Waters. I don't know if you've heard of it, but it works really well to protect your tomatoes once it gets cold. So he's recommended to a lot of people here, and I think some people have been trying that with good success. So, but you can always put like a cover, some type of a cover over your little seedlings if it's going to get cold and help protect them. I don't know if you ever have to do that there, Gary, if you get a lot of last minute, you know, cold temperatures that you got to run out there and cover everything, but that works pretty well too. Okay. There was a question here. I'm going to scroll back from Fabulia. Do you find that putting raised beds out take up more garden real estate? I'm assuming that means as opposed to like an in-ground garden or containers or something like that. Gary, do you have any comments on that?
Sure. So I would say it does, but there's benefits to it. And one of the things someone mentioned earlier when we were talking about starting your first garden, if you just do a 3-foot row in the earth and mound it up and you can go as long as you want, that sometimes takes up a less space. You can put more into there, and this way you can really do more crops. The raised bed is nice because if you're bringing it, I kind of call any bed that's like 4 inches off the ground, I call it more of a frame bed. But if you get to the raised bed height, 8 inches, 10 inches, it warms a little bit earlier. You can concentrate all your good resources in there. You can create a better, more loose soil for different things. So it does have its benefits. But if you were thinking more of farming and bringing in as much as you could produce wise, I think, you know, 3-foot rows just in the earth are probably the most efficient.
Yes, I think so. But raised beds definitely do have a huge benefit as well. They also drain really well, which could be an issue if you have, well, it's, I think it's a good thing to have drainage at any time. But if you have tons of rain, that might be a good thing to also consider as well. But the cool thing is, you know, just try one, like try a couple different ways. You know, I mean, I know like you've got all kinds of different methods that you're gardening in your garden, Gary, and I do as well here.
Right.
So try one raised bed, try it out for a season, try it out for a few months, see if you like it, try an in-ground, try some containers, and then you can always add more as time goes on. Okay, here's a good question from Omar, who is watching from Dubai. He's a regular viewer here on our live stream. And Omar says, do you have rosemary and neem oil available at your website, Gary? And do you deliver to Dubai?
Yes, we do. And no, we don't. Sorry. So shipping stuff over the seas is really challenging. One, the postage is expensive. Stuff does get lost. But more importantly, with customs, and a lot of the oils can't be shipped and it's problematic. And maybe down the line, if we grow and I have employees one day, I'm not sure that will happen. we could do more of that. But right now we just can't do it. The customs are just crazy for country to country.
Yeah, I think we're able to ship to like Australia, Canada, and US and the UK. Got a couple items returned from Australia. But yeah, pretty much at this time, that's, you know, COVID has kind of limited some stuff as well as far as shipping goes. Let's see, I saw another one. It was a good question for Gary. Where was it here? Let me scroll back through. Someone asked if you have any tips on growing onions.
Lots of water. So in a couple of videos I just did, I was showing off leeks and onions. So when you well, it depends. Let's go backwards. The easiest way to start onions is to get a handful of the seeds, just buy a seed packet, fill up a seed flat with starting mix, scatter your onion seeds in there, grow your own. You know, when they're maybe 6 inches tall, they're ready to go out into the garden. And those onions believe that they're first year onions, which means they're more likely to develop a nice onion bulb for you. When you're growing onions, you want to check your onion zone, which is different than your garden zone. So go online and just see where your state lies, because there's short day, midday, and long day onions. All depends on how much sunlight you get. So pick an onion that works. If you're in doubt, just get, you know, the middle of the road midday onion. But once you put onions into the ground, if it's by seed, if it's by transplant, you want to water more than you think. That first inch of soil is where the root systems are to start, and you don't want that to dry out. So if you water that every day over a week, 10 days, they're more likely to take hold. And you'll notice when you put onions in, they fall over, they're laying flat. If you start watering them, they're gonna perk up, and that's when you know they've established and they're good to go.
Great, good. Thank you so much for sharing that. Okay, let me just talk a little bit before we answer some more questions. We've been mentioning here a lot about the tomato contest. So Cliff, our moderator, is like the expert giant vegetable grower. He's actually kind of heading up the contest over in the Gardening Coast to Coast Facebook group. And for those of you watching, if you haven't, if you're interested in the tomato contest, head over to Gardening Coast to Coast on Facebook. Sure. And there'll be a link in the video description of this video once it uploads. And hopefully Nisha or Cliff can post one here real quick. But Gary and I had kind of started that group. Gary's kind of primarily been involved in that group. But it is a group of, I don't even know how many people, 30,000 gardeners from all over the world, would you say, Gary? Something like that.
Yeah,
so it's really fun to see people's comments and support from, you know, their experiences from different growing zones. It's a great place to get questions answered. Post photos of your garden and saying, help, you know, I'm having issues. And there's tons of people who are willing to jump in and help out. It's a really great community of gardeners. So all you have to do is go over, and I think there's a couple of questions you have to answer, request to join, and then you'll be able to join the group. And if you're interested in the contest, it's going to be on a pinned post at the top of the page. And we've actually done it for the past few years. I think we're going to take last year off. So it's a contest between Gary, myself, and Kevin at the Epic Garden, and all of you as well. And there's several different categories, like the largest tomato, the best looking tomato. One more category, Cliff, you can help me out with that. So the big question is, Gary, have you started your tomato yet for the contest? Because I've got mine going.
So I have not started. And the Facebook group, Gardening Coast to Coast?
Yes.
Number one, I apologize for all the spammers that are getting in there. Facebook has changed so much that it's ridiculous of how people can get in and kind of wreck the thread. So we're trying to fix that. And two, answer the questions. If you don't get in or something happens, answer them again, because there are literally hundreds of people coming in from all over just wanting to, you know, drop videos there. So sometimes the good people get lost and all that kind of stuff. So I am growing the Big Zach, the variety. The standard beefsteak going too already. The Big Zach is in a cup. It's about this tall, and it'll probably go in the ground in about 7 or 10 days. I'll be doing a video on, it's not really a secret, but it's going to be the secret to large tomatoes. And I'll be setting up that planting hole for the Big Zach. It's getting a lot of space, with lots of surface, with lots of room for its surface roots to grow out. So we'll see how it goes.
Okay. Well, you gave away a little bit of your secret already, but I'm sure you have a few more up your sleeve.
Yeah.
So we'll be definitely watching for those videos. And mine actually is already going pretty well. And I have a little leg up because I got seeds from the expert tomato grower himself, Cliff Warren. He's grown, I think, maybe 900 to 1,000 pound pumpkins. I don't even know how big your largest tomato is, Cliff, but I know he's constantly trying and entering different types of giant tomato contests. So Maybe this year I'll have a leg up on you, Gary. I know you beat me out in the past, but we'll give it a go this year and see how things go. So anyway, you guys, we would love to see a lot of your entries as well. And it's really just all about having fun, learning along the way, meeting other gardeners, and growing some of your own delicious tomatoes. I mean, who can't beat a homegrown tomato? So we look forward to seeing your entries over there as well. So let's see here. That's the end of my prepared questions for you, Gary. So we can head back into the chat, answer some more questions from viewers, and talk about any other things that come up here. Here's a great question. I know you've done some videos on this, Gary, from Kelly Fitzgerald. Does water or does hydrogen peroxide and water kill gnats in seedling soil?
Yes. That's it. No.
Yes.
So, so
you've got a video on it, I'm sure, right?
Hydrogen peroxide. I do have a video on it, actually. So hydrogen peroxide is great for the garden. And I think it's one of the kept secrets. Now, technically, it doesn't have an organic label on there because depending on how it's made or whatever, some people don't consider it organic. However, it's just hydrogen peroxide. You know, it's not going to hurt you, the plants, or anything like that. The whole key is when I first used it, maybe 5 years ago, I used the bottle from the grocery store, from the pharmacist, 3%, sprayed my peppers, and I defoliated, is that the right word? Defoliated everything. I killed off all the leaves. So you have to make sure that the ratio of hydrogen peroxide in water is correct. So for seed starts and, you know, kind of get watering them with it, I use a 4-to-1 ratio, 4 parts water, 1 part hydrogen peroxide. Some people use less, but you want to start with that and kind of test it. If it doesn't quite work, you can make it stronger, something like that. If you're going to a leaf spray, which I spray on my tomatoes, and that's really changed how I can garden. I grow them much more closely together. The Big Zach will be getting hydrogen peroxide as one of its treatments. I can grow tomatoes much more closely together because hydrogen peroxide basically cleans the leaves. And it just keeps my diseases down low, managed, and I've had great success with it. But before you use the product, if you check out my videos or you look other places, always test spray any plant variety, wait 48 hours, look for damage, and keep notes, and then you can kind of tweak it for it to work. It's not a miracle, spray, it doesn't fix everything.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I think that test spray is so important because a lot of times what people do is they'll be really excited about a new spray for their plant. Maybe they have aphids or some kind of issue and they'll go and spray their whole plant down, really having great intentions, of course, wanting to get rid of the issue, but then really disappointed because the plant doesn't respond well to it. And it's not even just the spray itself that you want to test, but the weather conditions can affect how a spray affects a plant, as well as the type of vegetable.
Right.
So you really want to test spray in all situations. Now I actually haven't ever used hydrogen peroxide. So maybe when we come out to visit this summer, you'll have to kind of show me how to use it and I'll be able to try it out or watch some of your videos and try it out and see how it works here in my garden too. So it'd be a cool experiment.
When the contest is.
That's right. Now you just gave me your secret. I'll try it on my tomato too.
Right.
So. Okay.
Can I add something to that?
I'm sorry, what?
Can I add something?
Oh, yeah,
of
course.
Something to your, So, I mean, one is sometimes the questions come in a lot too is like, what do I feed my plant? What do they need? When do I feed it?
Yes.
Like the sprays, fertilizing, you can overlove your plants and do more damage. You can put too many sprays on them. Like you may not need H2O2 in your garden, but you know. But you don't want to overlove your plants. You don't want to put on unnecessary sprays. You don't want to double up. Like for instance, if you say you did baking soda a week ago and then you do hydrogen peroxide today and then you do neem oil in 5 days, that builds up on the leaves. So it kind of builds up and can damage leaves. So you want to use sprays only when you need them. And if you need them, you want to spray usually a couple weeks before the problem arises. And I know that's weird, but take notes of when they show up and then you know to start spraying sooner. And then same thing with feeding your plants. You could use fish emulsion. That's a great organic fertilizer. You could use a granular, but you don't necessarily need to put a granular down and then worm castings and then compost and then, you know, some other thing, maybe kelp meal, and then keep piling on the fertilizers because you can concentrate the fertilizer so much that it looks like it's hurting your plants. And then you think, well, they're turning yellow or they're turning purple. I better give them more fertilizer. And then you can damage them. It doesn't happen so much in the ground, but if you're growing in containers where that fertilizer stays concentrated, it can cause harm. So the whole point is just slow, steady fertilizing, and you'll have more success. At least
I think that's
opinion.
A really good point, because all of us, you know, tend to, I know for myself, I really have to kind of regulate that because I want my plants to do well. And I kind of get a little panicked feeling when I see, oh my gosh, my tomato plant in my container is not doing so well, and then tend to add more. So sometimes just backing off right. and letting kind of the plant do its thing will help correct the problem. Kind of keep an eye on it and engage it a little bit. But sometimes that'll really help as well. So resist that tendency, because I have that same issue too. Okay, I've seen some good questions scroll by here. Let's see. Gary, if you see any, you know, go ahead and shout them out too.
Sure. Here's one. How often should I use Epsom salt in 5-gallon buckets for tomatoes and peppers? So we hear a lot, excuse me, about magnesium sulfate, which is Epsom salt.
Mm-hmm.
And I've done videos on it, and it works. However, originally, I probably said use it too often, and it's kind of gotten this fantastical, mythological, super fertilizer. It adds magnesium and sulfur, which are your second level macronutrients. So you don't need a lot of it. And if you put too much of that into your root systems, be it in containers, which are more susceptible, or even in the ground, it can lock out how that plant pulls in calcium and other nutrients. So the point being is, I use maybe 1 or 2 tablespoons of the Epsom salt in a gallon of water, quickly sprinkle the tomato leaves, the root base, and maybe do it twice a year now, you know, in the beginning,
cool.
mid-growth, maybe towards the end. You just don't need that much. So that's where you can, and that's actually a good point to add to what I said earlier. That's where you can start overloving your plants. You're already putting in the fertilizer, and now you're putting in magnesium, sulfate, and you can over concentrate that, and then the plant looks like it's suffering, but it's suffering because there's too much in there. So it works. It's great for containers, but less and infrequent is better.
Yeah, and I think just for people to keep it simple, because it can really be overwhelming when you start looking at all these different items that you can use in your garden. But just try a couple things, keep it simple. You don't have to run out and purchase everything out there. I mean, I probably just use 3 main things, the worm castings, compost, and I pretty much stuck with the good dirt plant food the past couple of years because it has everything that my plants need. And that saves me from, you know, picking up every fertilizer at the garden center every time I go. And then a couple things for pest control, and you're pretty much good to go. So, you know, find things that work for you and, you know, talk to other gardeners. We have a lot of, you know, recommendations, you know, on our YouTube channels and here on the live stream, and then just kind of stick to those and keep things simple.
Can
so,
I answer
okay.
that?
Here's a question from Jack. And I know Jack actually is not too far from you there in Maryland. So, hi Jack, how's it going? Jack says, how do I know when broccoli is about to flower? My heads are about 2 inches in diameter, but feel a bit loose. It's a great question, Jack. And Gary, we have a tough time growing broccoli here because we get so much heat in the wintertime. So I don't know how it is for you there in Maryland, but maybe you could address Jack's question since you live so close to him.
He answered it. So when the head starts getting loose, it's about the flower. So you kind of missed it. And the weather here on our coast, you're coming out of freezing, and these plants can freeze and frost, and they can do things. Mm-hmm. They can handle that kind of temperature. But then it jumps so quickly to the heat, the soil warms up. And it's actually not the ambient heat around the plant that causes it. It's the warmth in the root system that causes plants to flower and bolt, generally speaking. So it's really hard to grow that here. And in fact, I maybe have 2 plants in just for an experiment, and I eat the leaves and the buds when they're just small.
Mm-hmm.
But I start all mine now in August, and I let them grow into September, October, November, because that's the cool temperature they need, and that keeps that head from loosening up and flowering. I wanted to add one thing too to our last question.
Sure.
Because you're right, you use 3 different products,
mm-hmm.
and that's perfect. You kind of cover your bases. For people that don't know, compost, generally speaking, is well below a 1:1:1 nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. Slow, steady feed. That's the true essence of organic gardening for thousands of years, using, you know, the stuff around your landscape, your community, your homestead. And it works for a reason. That's why all the leaves under trees and the forest floor are fantastic. It's just a slow, steady release of the elements. Organic gardening kind of got taken commercial over the last 10 or 20 years, where you walk into a store and you see organic or natural and organic, or you see, you know, use this or the other stuff as poison, you know, which is not true. But organic gardening is wonderful. What becomes a problem is you'll see tomato fertilizer, pepper fertilizer, holly fertilizer, you'll see lettuce fertilizer, you'll see fruit fertilizer, and you'll just see all these things where the ingredients are basically the same. Bone meal, blood meal, feather meal, chicken manure, a couple other things thrown in. So you don't need all that. And I just wanted to stress that, is that you don't need anything specialized for all your different crops. You just need a granular organic, a water-soluble organic compost, and pick the ones that you like. I also use the chemical fertilizers rarely, but I use them in emergencies, like when frost damage comes in and damages my plant. Mm-hmm. Chemical fertilizers won't hurt your plants. They won't hurt the soil. They won't hurt you unless you use them wrong and you abuse them. And that's what happened in the 50s and the 60s, where they just threw down tons of these artificial chemicals. They didn't take care of the soil. It caused problems. But be organic when you can. If you're on a budget and you can't afford them, some chemical fertilizers won't hurt you. But don't get fooled into thinking you need 30 different bags of specialized fertilizers for your crops. It'll save you a lot of money just picking three like you did.
That's great advice. And I mean, start your own compost pile too, because that's one way that if you are on a budget, which a lot of people are, you can really fertilize your garden for free. And I think it's a really great feeling too, just to know that we're not throwing all that into the landfill. We're making, you know, free garden gold, black gold for our plants. And I don't know about you, but I love the smell of finished compost. It just smells earthy. It smells fresh.
Oh, yeah.
And just makes me feel good that I'm putting something that I made on my garden, which in turn feeds me and feeds our family. In fact, we just did a pea harvest video yesterday. We harvested a ton of peas. It was a really good feeling because we had plenty for us. I gave some to a couple of friends and neighbors. So a couple people stopped by and were able to have some. And they said, "Did you grow these?" And it's just such a good feeling. And I know a lot of you can relate to this too, to say, "Yeah, I grew it. It's out in my backyard." And they, you know, ranted and raved about how tasty and delicious they are. And that's from, you know, my compost and things that I took the time to plant and grow and nurture. And it's just such a great feeling. Okay. And I think a lot of people can relate to that. And it's also a very relaxing feeling to walk outside and harvest and bring it indoors. So it's real, very, very rewarding. Okay.
These are great to grow in a 5-gallon bucket.
Yeah, they work great in containers. They work absolutely wonderful. So let's see here. Let's scroll through and find a few more questions before we close it out for today here. Lots of questions I know I missed. So sorry if we didn't get to your question, guys. Oh, I just saw the super chat here. Sorry, Melissa, if I missed that earlier. There's a super chat for $4.99 from Melissa. Thank you so much for your support. Really appreciate it. And Melissa is saying, "I'm growing peas. They finally have blooms, but it's getting hot now. It's I'm a handle grow pot. It's in a handle grow pot. Should I bring them inside and use grow lights again?" Melissa, I think that's going to be a little bit tough unless you have a pretty good grow light indoors. You know, it's always sad. I'm actually really sad right now because a lot of my cool weather crops are kind of coming to an end. And I know that's tough, but it's just kind of part of the cycle of gardening. So it's just kind of a sign that it's time to get your garden ready for some warm weather vegetables. You can extend the life a little bit in the heat. We have lots of experience here by covering it up with shade cloth, and that will definitely help extend it maybe a little bit. But eventually your peas are going to succumb to the heat. It might be a little more, I mean, you can give it a try, experiment, but I think it might be a little bit more trouble than you think, especially with the grow light situation. So you have any comments on that, Gary?
Peas are self-pollinating. So in theory, peppers are self-pollinating. Tomatoes are self-pollinating. You just have to shake them. So plants, if you look up, just look up self-pollinating peas and it'll tell you. So you could grow this inside. You don't need insects, but you would need, like you were saying, probably not the grow lights. You need specialized grow lights for that. But if you're getting a full south facing window, or you're getting enough sun coming in, or if it is in containers and you move them to where there's more shade, you can extend the life just like using the shade cloth. If the feet of the peas stay a little bit cooler, then it prolongs, you know, the production of the plant.
Definitely could get a little bit more out of it. So maybe that'll help you, you know, stave off the peas succumbing to the heat. Okay, question here. This is probably a good one for you, Gary, too, from Sylvia. What do I do for my container plants after several days of very heavy rain? Should I add liquid fertilizer? I'm afraid that the nutrients are washed out. You get so much rain there, I'm sure you could probably speak to that.
Right. So that is possible, and that's one of the things. I mean, I'm assuming you have drainage, which is, you know, which is you need. So all your containers need drainage. But it is possible with the amount of rain to have things flushed out. In fact, if you over-fertilize a plant, you can flush out a lot of it. But depending on your container mix and how things are set up, I mean, without getting too technical, you have the cations and anions and how the molecules kind of bind in the soil. So it's hard to flush everything out. So the nutrients stay there. But that would be the perfect case if you're concerned and it just seems like the plants are struggling. You know, fish emulsion is usually like a 5-1-1 N, P, and K. You can just give it a low dose of a liquid fertilizer and you'll know that you have it back in there. And just keep an eye on it. If you're always going low, slow, and steady, you're not going to damage your plants. And you can always add more because you're like, well, I didn't really give them that much. They look a little yellow. They probably need nitrogen. So you give them a little more. Wait a couple of days. If they respond, you're good. If not, you know, add a little more.
That's good advice. So just do a little bit at a time and then see how your plants respond. That's one thing I really like about the worm tea too and the worm castings. It is a slow and steady type of growth where you're not like, it gives your plants a little bit of a boost, yeah. But it just keeps them healthy. You know, helps keep the pests and diseases away. But you know, you're not like over loving them and it's not going to burn your plants either. So let's see here. Scroll through the questions. Whoa, the chat is like flying by here. I know I missed a lot. Oh, we missed another super chat. Thank you so much, Garden State Gardener, for a super chat of $5. Really appreciate that. Thanks for all your support. And Gary and I are hoping to do more collaborations. I think I might have mentioned Jerry and I are going to be heading out to see Gary and his wife. And maybe I didn't mention this summer. So be watching for some more videos. I know last time we went out, I don't know how many videos we filmed, Gary. We probably filmed 5 or 6 or more. We did some Q&As. We did tomatoes. It was really fun, though. Right. It was a lot of fun to be able to kind of bounce ideas off of each other and brainstorm and shoot videos together. So that'll be fun to do that again.
And we can update. Yeah, we can update everybody in Gardening Coast to Coast because we were talking, we're planning on doing more Q&A. And maybe, you know, something for an hour where we just go over, you know, every question that comes up or something like that, but something more relaxed and more fun. I'm going to invite you into Friday morning ramblings and we'll just talk about stuff and wander around. But I think it'll be a lot of fun. Looking forward to seeing you.
Yeah. And we'll do another live together. 100% when we're there.
Humidity.
What's that?
Yeah. And it'll be nice and humid. So
we'll get ready for
be
it.
Ready.
That's right.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll take a couple more questions before we close out for the day. And this has been a ton of fun. So I'm really appreciative for Gary for taking the time out to be here. So here we have a question from Russ Lisa. Basil seeds germinated, but they've remained stunted. How can I get them growing again, or should I restart? Well,
I missed the first part.
What's that? The first part? It said
I missed the first part.
She started her basil seeds. They germinated, but they've remained stunted. How can I get them growing again, or should I restart? Well, I'll kind of comment to that, Gary, and then you can. I always like to have backups growing. Like if there looks like there's an issue with the plant, I will usually start more just in case because I never want to put all my eggs in one basket and then I'm stuck without basil plants. So I would say, go ahead and get more started just in case. And then you can kind of go from there. Sometimes what I found that, especially when the temperatures start to warm up, I keep a lot of my plants in my grow light closet and it tends to get really hot in there. So sometimes things will kind of slow down a little bit. I'll have to open the door, get some airflow going. It happened with some of my tomato and pepper starts. And then they kind of took off again once I kind of adjusted the temperature and the location of where they were at. So that did kind of help. But get some backups going. So Gary, any thoughts for her?
Yeah, well, first thing, someone said when you come down, can we have a hot pepper eating contest?
Which, oh boy,
no, we're not going to
do. I don't know about that one.
So
maybe we'll have to make Jerry do that.
I've got
he really likes spicy food. Not really. He does not like spicy food.
Well, Jerry can do it. I have scorpion peppers and ghost peppers growing, I give away. I don't eat, but
I don't know
Jerry
about
wants
that.
To try it, that's fine.
I don't know, but we'll think of something else fun to do.
So the basil, I agree, is have backups. So if you're starting by seed, a lot of things can happen. Sometimes it's too humid, the soil's too moist, something is going on with the root system, it's not growing well. You can always give it the worm casting tea is great, or a very low water soluble fertilizer, just a dash, see if that helps. Get it outside into the sun, let the top of the seed starting mix dry before you water it, see if that kind of gets it going again. But I would start more in larger cups or larger cells maybe, and just keep that, you know, every 2 weeks of sowing basil seeds going, because I think it makes a difference. And that'll allow you to have it throughout the season. When you can get out into the containers, into the ground, certainly drop seeds into the ground too. And this way, something's gonna catch for you.
Definitely, definitely. And basil's so easy to grow that you can easily grow that throughout the summer. Succession planting is a great strategy to use so that you don't get all your harvest at once, kind of spread things out and be able to share with other people as well throughout the growing season. Connie, I see your super chat here. Thank you so much to Connie Graham, $20 super chat. And she's a regular here every Monday. And Connie says, I've watched many hours of you two. I have learned a ton, and just as importantly, very inspiring. So Connie, thank you. That really does mean a lot to, I know, to Jerry and I, and I know to Gary as well. Just to know that people are inspired and motivated, that it's helping them be healthier and helping change their lives. It really does help us get out there and make the videos and do the live streams, and just to know that people's lives are really being affected. So thank you so much, Connie. I really appreciate it. Okay, let's see if there's any other questions here. Here's actually a good one with summer vacation season coming up. And us talking about a trip is from Koa. It says, Kim, what are your tips for leaving your garden to go on vacation? Well, we've actually gone on vacation like before for about 10 days one time, and everything in my garden is pretty much automated as far as watering goes. So that makes it a lot easier. Everything's on drip irrigation, on timers. But before we leave, I am always, you know, rushing around to make sure everything's working properly, just checking to make sure the batteries are in the timers, that nothing's spraying out and leaking off everywhere, and just making sure everything's on automatic. And then if I can, I'll usually have someone come and check on things a couple of times if possible. But we did leave for one time, had a terrible heat wave, and came back to a couple of dead strawberry towers, which actually bounced right back. So, you know, that's my best suggestion. It might be a little more challenging for you, Gary, without the drip. So hopefully, I know you just went on a trip for about 5 days. So how did you handle that when you were gone without drip irrigation?
So luckily, in the East Coast, everything is still cold, so nothing was really in the ground.
It's different.
So I travel like, I don't know, October through March, a little bit into April, and my garden's pretty good. In the July, August time, I have to have somebody come in and water. And usually I set up sprinkler towers in the corner of my yard, and I just give instructions on how long to turn them on, and that usually works. And I will put anything that's in containers or whatever into a central location so that watering's pretty easy.
Yeah.
But I have to have somebody come
good idea.
Probably every 3 days or so and turn the water on.
Okay. Now, one thing that I know people can do too, if they live in a small, you know, like have a small growing space, is they can put their containers like in tubs, like in the plastic storage tubs, or like in a kiddie swimming pool, and fill those with water, and then have someone come in and check on those to make sure that all the water, you know, if it gets absorbed, that they're able to refill it. And that will kind of help, you know, while you're gone, to keep your plants hydrated. Okay, let's see here. Maybe we'll take one or two more questions. Gear, if you see some in there, go ahead and shout them out.
Sure.
Just kind of scrolling through here. I really love seeing all the comments. Appreciate the energy and wealth of knowledge. We have been blessed. Thank you so much. That was from Mackle. Appreciate that. I'm going to scroll down to the bottom of the chat here. More collaborations. Thank you very much, Connie. Let's see. Kelly says, Gary, I'm growing Juliet tomatoes this year after watching your video. I hope they look as good as yours did. Very cool.
The Juliet's? Yeah, I saw that.
Good. Okay. Catherine Sloan is a good question. Is it possible to not kill all the other plants when thinning seedlings? Go for it, Gary. You can take that one.
I'm assuming she means don't use something with the seedlings that you thin so that you don't have to kill them. Is that?
I'm thinking, yeah.
The gist of it. Yeah, so if you're pulling radishes or you're thinning and stuff like that, I actually eat them while I'm pulling them out. You can't really save them. If you're seed starting and you have like a couple tomatoes in a little cell or peppers in a cell, you can let that mix dry a good bit and then kind of tap the root ball, pull it apart, and then you can plant them that way. But if you're pulling stuff out of the garden, it's really hard to save those because so much of the root's getting damaged when you're pulling it out. It's not really worth it. But a lot of the plants you can eat, you know, just plan to have that with your lunchtime salad or something like that. Throw them.
You can eat little baby greens or baby whatever if you're thinning out your lettuce or your kale. One thing I like to do when I'm thinning something like in the garden, like a tomato plant is, like you said, is very easy to separate in a container of tomato seedlings. You can separate very easily from peat pellets. But I will snip it at the base of the plant rather than pull it out if it's a seedling that I'm, you know, kind of getting rid of or want to eat. That way you're kind of saving damaging the roots around the seedlings that you're keeping. So give that a try, and that'll probably work really well for you too. Okay, here's a good question from Anne. What do you plant in your garden after lettuce? Very good question, because all of my lettuce, for the most part, is starting to bolt after the heat from last week. So I'm already thinking, what am I going to put in there next? Probably what I'm going to do is start getting some heat-tolerant greens growing, some kale and some chard. I already have some in. So just get some things going that will tolerate the heat more, because the lettuce is bolting due to the hot temperatures. But you can also mix things up a little bit. I think where I have my salad station, I may end up putting some beans in. I'm not sure. So just kind of be thinking, if you can, like a month ahead or so, either get some seedlings going in the house or just plant some seeds in that location and then just wait for them to grow. So any advice there, Gary, from you?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's the general idea. So your cool weather crops usually can take a frost. Their leaf structure can freeze. It doesn't get damaged. They like soil temperatures that are like 40 degrees, 50 degrees, so to speak. When that temperature gets to 50 to 60 degrees, when the soil temperature gets to that, a lot of the cool weather crops, you have to move towards the more shadier part or start transitioning over to the warm crops, which are your tomatoes, peppers, zucchini, squash. Green beans are great to start planting. Okra, bunching onions you can keep going. Cilantro you can put down. Your kale, your Swiss chard, like you said, that can manage through the heat too. You can put that in for your leafy greens. I would kind of just eyeball them and maybe put in radishes mature in like 25 to 30 days. Just see what makes it until they don't, and then kind of keep notes. This way you know how late you can put in lettuce seeds, how many radish seeds you can put in every 2 weeks before they just don't produce what you want. And each area is going to be a little bit different. So you want to take notes and you want to say, I put radish seeds in today, which was what, May 3rd, and they produced before the heat came. And this way, you know, you can follow that year after year.
Well, you're a lot better at taking notes than I am. So hopefully you have I know you have a garden journal on your website. That I have one of those as well too, but right. I think you're a lot more organized in that way than I am. I just kind of try and remember, which doesn't always work out so well. But like you're talking about radishes, right. Like it is way too late for us here in California to do radishes. They would never make it. So it just, you know, you really just have to play with your climates. And from year every year, you learn a little bit more and you know when you can get things out and when it's too late to plant the cool weather vegetables. So great advice. Well, I think we're going to go ahead and wrap it up for today. I'll just scroll through the chat real briefly here. This has been a ton of fun. Gary, thank you so much for hanging out with us. We look forward to doing more collaborations in the future and really look forward to coming out to see you and Angela in July and filming a bunch of videos together and hanging out in the garden. Something about hanging out with other gardeners that just
be a lot of fun.
Is very inspiring. So, all right, guys, thanks so much for joining
us. And my wife will appreciate it.
I'm sorry, Gary, go ahead. Appreciate you, everyone, hanging out.
Great to have you.
Your encouraging comments. And we will see you guys on next Monday's live stream and hope you guys all have a wonderful week. Bye-bye.